Good evening. Thank you, Gunjan, for being here. We have with us today Mr. Gunjan Sinha, the chairman of Metric Stream, a US-based company that is doing some pathbreaking work in India and around the world. So, you know, India, the topic here is basically everyone's talking about the fact that India needs to revive its GDP, India needs to really move things to the next level. There's a huge amount of problems that the country has been discussing, and very honestly, I think all of them, while as they're very, very contextual, but having said that, not much seems to be coming through as far as that is concerned. One of the solutions that is being presented is the fourth industrial revolution, the fact that manufacturing really needs to evolve and really needs to raise its head in a very significant manner to really be able to create jobs and address several problems in and deliver collateral benefits, if we can call it. And, so while that's a great thought, but tell me, what do you think, what is your opinion on, does India really have the skill, the talent, the capability, the ability to use technology and to harness technology to be able to do that? You know, how is technology a challenge, or is it really an advantage? How do you think it's going to pan out for India?
Firstly, thank you, Parag, for inviting me on this platform here. And it's a pleasure to be here. Having lived in Silicon Valley for now almost over 30 years, having grown up in India and then built a number of businesses in Silicon Valley, in India and around the world, including Metric Stream and a number of other companies, I do feel that India has a tremendous, tremendous opportunity ahead of us if harnessed correctly. And I firmly believe that one of the theories that's going to play out over the next decade is organizations and countries and nations which truly have the power of diversity and inclusiveness are going to rise in a significant way, because diversity brings real human creativity and to power to create and to drive real transformations. India, being one of the largest democracies in the world, really has the opportunity to value diversity. It can actually take people who have privileges, people who don't have privileges, people who are lost in the middle, to bring it together. And for that, I think the nation, can harness that moving forward to bring about the digital transformation, in my mind. And for that, we need to really bring in the next generation, the millennials, to the forefront. I mean, when I, graduated from college back in 1980s to where we are today, it was a different era. But looking ahead, when I look at the business opportunities in India and globally, is that we have to bring in the youth, and that's the opportunity. So to me, the next generation is going to take us to really kind of creating the skills dividend, the population dividend that India truly has, and bring that to the forefront.
So to harness this demographic dividend, as you rightly said, what is the stimulus that the government really needs to give the economy? Something's got to get done. Things can't just be left in idle mode. So, while the youth is very capable, and, I totally see your point, and everybody understands that, recognizes that, but they are the ones who are most flustered at this point in time. They're totally, they've educated themselves well. They've kind of set themselves up for a great future, but that future is a little hazy. So, what is your message, or to the government as well as to the on the youth side, as to how should they really converge?
Yeah, and I think the answer for that lies in two simple words. I kind of call it really stirring the startup economy. Because if you look at the millennials, the next generation of jobs are going to get created by younger companies. People with few employees trying to reinvent things and building the next horizon, and allowing India to leapfrog into the digital transformation. So as part of the national government of India, I think we have to think about how we can stir that economy, the startup economy. For example, one of the initiatives that I was personally part of was a collaboration between US State Department and Department of Science and Technology of India, where we created a $50 million fund to stir younger people to come out with ideas, where we would give a $500,000 grants to stir the startup economy, the incubation of ideas and so forth. That needs to be done at scale throughout the country, even in smaller cities and smaller towns, because there's so much talent. So if you take the combination of the millennials and the startup economy, that's where you create the catalyst and the growth. And the way I would think of it is, you know, with me right here is we've got Anya and then Rhea, and they're both part of our family. And the reason why I thought they will be great guests here is because they represent not just being part of my family, but they represent what I call the next generation of millennials who are very cognizant of their privileges, who understand their privileges, but they're also now willing to take that and bring that for their own interest, but also for the national interest, saying, okay, how do I create the next set of opportunities? How do I create, you know, more equity and more balanced development of skills and leadership and inspire people to doing that? So Anya, I know, has done a ton of work in both public service, but, you know, as part of the MetricStream team, but also outside. And she can talk about some of the initiatives she has undertaken to stir the younger people around the country in that. And I know Rhea, you know, she's launched something for younger women to do certain things called Fuchsia. She can touch upon that. But these are just two examples of what I think younger next generation can do through the power of startups and through innovation and leadership.
Oh, that's brilliant. So, you know, let's hear it from Anya to begin with as to, you know, I mean, what have you done and how do you think it's making, delivering impact?
Right. So I think just to take a step back, what I feel in general in terms of what is required in India and, you know, what is the millennial mindset, I would really say is that I think people rightfully say that millennials have a different mindset than previous generations. So, you know, they're aware of the fact that they want opportunities, they want a certain type of life, at the same time, they want flexibility, etc. So those are some of the things that are almost expectations. But what that does give rise to is also creativity and innovation. And, you know, growth. So I think today what we need to do in India is harness that energy that's there amongst, you know, the younger generation, where I think there's a large section of the population that doesn't necessarily want to go into structured work, but is ready and willing to creatively work towards executing ideas. It could be anything from, you know, an organization like Harassus bringing young leaders together, which is something that I've been involved in, and really building a community around that, right? And where the government comes in is, I think there's not enough policies and structures and impetus given to young individuals and entrepreneurs, which can be given in the form of, you know, change in policy, tax breaks, just providing them the career, the correct resources, technology, etc. And I think that would make a big difference in, you know, getting more startups, more entrepreneurs on the ground, and then also keeping talent in India. I think that's another big area to focus on that, you know, even today, I think once startups are of a certain degree, a lot of startups, especially if they're specifically, you know, focused on an area, have to leave or have to get resources from outside. So I think that would make a big difference.
Yeah, I mean, basically reverse the proverbial brain drain that basically, you know, that took place in the 80s. And,
yeah,
the 90s.
Exactly.
Yeah, that's right.
And there's tremendous opportunity in India, right? With the, I mean, the demograph, while there are negative consequences, the fact is that the number of consumers that we have, it's tremendous. It's unparalleled to anywhere in the world. And with, you know, with access to data, technology, it's just increasing.
So I have a question for you, Anya. Do you think the youngsters like yourselves need to create more IP?
Yeah.
Need to really focus on creating more, you know, IP, I think, is going to be the source of,
right,
of basically scaling in the future.
Yeah.
Today,
yeah,
a lot of IP, and I think India is somewhere falling
yes,
back on
yeah.
that. So what are your thoughts on you know, encouraging
yeah.
youngsters
yeah.
to develop IP?
Because yeah, yeah. No, I mean, absolutely. I completely and totally agree. And I think, you know, there's two reasons, again, why, you know, that may not be happening at the pace that we want it to. One is probably the environment and the resources that are not necessarily encouraging that in the right way. And the second thing is that, you know, with digitization and technology, we need a different set of skills today. you know, as a young person or anyone, you need the kind of skills that you need, which will really make you succeed, are different than what was perhaps required. And our education system is not necessarily geared towards giving us those skills. So, you know, a lot of it is going and getting it out
on
your own.
Is it probably not, you know, not adequate policy?
Yeah, it all goes, I think, hand in hand, right? From policy to education, it's all of it. But I think the system doesn't necessarily, you know, take you there at this point. It's not quite aligned yet.
Right.
So I think that's the biggest miss, but it's absolutely something that's required today.
Right. You know, perhaps a case in point would be the Flipkarts
of
the world, you know, which were compelled to go out and house themselves in Singapore.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, while they just for the, they re-domiciled themselves simply for the sake of the environment.
Exactly. And I think we see those examples all around. So that's, there is a need to align that across different sectors.
So let's hear it from Ria. You know, tell us about what you're doing.
So I was born and brought up in the Silicon Valley, but I founded my own company like 5 or 6 years ago called Fuzia, F-U-Z-I-A. And it's essentially a company for women from all around the world to share their creative work online and learn from one another. So women post their art, their poetry, or whatever type of creative expression that they want and gain empowerment from that. And essentially what we're doing is creating a community of really strong women from all around the world. And we currently have more than 4 million followers on social media.
Is that right?
Yeah, and then around 20,000 women using the website. And we've seen that by far our largest demographic is in fact young Indian women around the ages of 13 or 14 to around 30 years old. Mm-hmm. And so that's really like a huge pool of talent that I feel is mostly untapped in many ways, because they have so much skill for small things like jewelry design or, you know, art or like writing and blogging.
Maybe just a recipe?
Yeah, even just cooking or whatever it is. And I think that through Fuzia, they're able to gain voice and exposure. And there's just one specific example of a girl who's from Bhopal. She won one of Fuzia's campaigns and contests. She won one of the writing contests that Fuzia hosted. And because of that, a small town in Bhopal actually put her name and what she won on a billboard in her city. And so that was just, she was so happy to be able to gain that exposure. And through Fuzia, she's been able to do that. And so I think we can be able to use companies like Fuzia or other people who want to start companies like this to both be for profit and also benefit the community in general.
So do you also have a way of helping them further scale in terms of their own aspirations first, and then whatever their activity is to be able to, you know, develop into a sustainable activity?
Yeah.
Or is it just about gaining initial recognition, appreciation, and then feeling that confidence, sense
of
confidence?
Yeah, exactly. So I think right now it's a lot for the woman feeling that confidence, because a lot of them simply do not have the resources or even just the emotional confidence to be able to go out and tell people, hey, look at
That's
my
right.
work, look what I'm doing. And so I think Fuzia really gives them that strong community that supports them. And then I think we've seen slowly that women are going back and becoming leaders in their own way in their own communities. You know, they're being more confident. And through the women that I've had conversations with on the website, I can see them grow, and they've said, oh, like I've, you know, like stood up to my family more, I've talked to my family more about certain issues. And I think that the website does give them the initial confidence to reach out more in their own communities. So
that
I think it's
brilliant.
Giving them that
as
well.
That is brilliant. I think women empowerment is going to be the keystone of, you know, it's unfortunate we are living in a world where we have to empower women because they were always empowered. You know, I mean, if we go back into our history, but yes, the truth is that, and I think what you're doing is incredible, because, you know, just bringing out that confidence in them and that sense of belief in themselves is incredible.
And then this was the reason, you know, I thought, you know, just having both Anya and Ria here, because Anya's focus on just leadership development in the youth in India, or what Ria is doing with Fuzia in times of empowering women and giving them a platform where they can start to showcase their talent and develop the talent, are just two examples. But I think that therein lies the answer for the country, in my mind, with what I say, people with privileges, like I went to IIT, you know, I have to understand that, you know, that's a special privilege.
Right.
You know, so you owe it upon back into the country to figuring out how you can leverage that and do the right thing. And I think if the government of India's policy supports them to be able to take and venture out and actually create that whole innovation-led creative startup economy, that I think will fuel an India which will be unparalleled, because the combination of democracy, diversity, inclusiveness, that's what drives, you know, human creativity and innovation. So to me, therein lies an answer which is going to be making India an unstoppable force in the future. And I'm very bullish on it. I feel like, you know, especially with the new government in play,
yes,
I am very hopeful that, you know, this is going to turn around and happen now.
So, no, I think, you know, you're right. The new government has come in with a firm, steely resolve.
Yeah.
I think their intent to execute, to deliver this time around, you know, is clearly visible.
Yeah.
And let's hope for good times. Thank you for doing what you're doing.
Yeah.
I mean, A, in terms of what you are doing, and B, in terms of how you're mentoring youngsters and, you know, and having them shape the world going forward. And thank you, both of you, for, you know, just keep at it and, you know, spread the message. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.